Chants of freedom, Cuban Americans gathering in the streets for the second night, celebrating the death of Fidel Castro.
My poor father did have stark pride all day long.
Emotions running high, local politicians reacting to the news. It's hitting close to home for many Cuban American politicians, the death giving hope to many who've been pushing for change.
Today, in a special This Week in South Florida, we take a look at the death of Fidel Castro and what may lie ahead for the island nation. Good morning, everyone. I'm Nikki Mohan, in for Michael Putney, who's under the weather today.
I'm Todd Tongan, in for Glenna Milberg, who is on assignment in Havana, Cuba.
Before we get to today's guests, we want to head to Havana. That's where we have Hatzel Vela, the only South Florida reporter there on the island right now. He was there from yesterday morning. Good morning, Hatzel. And you said already you saw some preparations underway for the memorial.
Yeah, let's go ahead and show you some pictures that we took. This is a picture from Revolution Square, Plaza de la Revolución. That's because that is going to be the site starting tomorrow where we're going to see people paying homage to Fidel Castro. You see some scaffolding there. Specifically, what is going to happen is at the José Martí Memorial, his remains will be there for people to walk by and pay their respects. Also, let's go ahead and show you some video here. This is video of state-run television here in Havana and throughout the island. This is what we've been seeing all day, all night. This is a homage to Fidel. So what you'll see from time to time is you'll have two newscasters talking about his life. Then they go to interviews, documentaries, reaction from all over the country and all over the world and Latin America. And so it's a mix of content that people are being provided here around Havana and, of course, throughout the island, remembrance of the life of Fidel Castro. We also saw on state-run television Elian Gonzalez, who is now an adult, obviously a prominent person when it comes to Miami exile politics and Cuban relationship with the exile community. Elian talking about the role that Castro played in his life, talking about the role that Castro played in the history of Cuba. At one point, we saw him get slightly emotional, obviously a figure there that means a lot to the South Florida community. So a lot of stuff going on here in Havana, Cuba. When you walk around, the one thing that you will not see is the music playing, which is really odd because music is such a huge part of the Cuban culture here. And so you talk to tourists, and that's one thing that they're kind of sad that they're not seeing, because they're here to get that experience. But at the same time, they understand what's happening and the somber mood that the country is under at this hour.
Hatzel, in a joint press conference yesterday, the Diaz-Balart brothers, as well as Carlos Curbelo and Ileana Ross-Layton, all four of them said that they had been getting reports that freedom fighters were, quote, being rounded up and detained. Have you seen any evidence of that?
No, we have been in touch with some of the dissidents, high-profile dissidents. At this point, we're not hearing that. Of course, that could very well be happening. Remember, you have dissidents all throughout the island. I mean, most of the high-profile ones are here in Havana, but you have Guillermo Fariñas out in Santa Clara. We haven't been able to talk to him, so we cannot verify those reports. We would not be surprised if that is the case. We did hear that the ladies in white had canceled the regularly scheduled Sunday protest out of respect for what's happening. It's going to be interesting to see what happens in the next couple of days. We will be in touch with those dissidents because we want to hear from them as to what is happening. We did hear from Jose Daniel Ferrer. I did see a posting on YouTube where he talked about the mood in Santiago de Cuba and what people were doing, going about their ways, he said. So at this point, we're not sure who's being rounded up or who's been arrested, but I cannot verify those reports, only to say, though, that we will be in touch with those people to make sure that they are not arrested and to make sure that we talk to them about what's happening here on the island.
Hatzel, we've also been hearing reports that they may be blocking Wi-Fi and access to outside information about how people are reacting to the passing of the leader. Have you heard anything about that?
You know what? That's an interesting point that has not been the case from my experience. When I say my experience is when you walk around into Havana, there's an area called La Rampa. That's the only place I've seen that has Wi-Fi. Wi-Fi is in different spots throughout the capital city here. When you go to other smaller towns, it's typically in the center of town, but here in Havana, because it is the capital, there's different spots. At that particular place where I told you about called Las Zampas, there was dozens of typically young folks stuck on Wi-Fi. It is the rage here in Cuba. I did not see folks complaining about lack of Wi-Fi, although one of our viewers said that she heard it was happening in Santa Clara. But at this point, we're not in Santa Clara, so we cannot tell you if that is happening there. Wi-Fi is not reliable in this country, so it could be that that is the reason people are talking about, and I cannot attest to the fact that whether the government is purposely cutting Wi-Fi so that people do not see what's going on outside the world. Of course, as we saw with Cuban state-run television, they are only seeing that. So unless you have Wi-Fi and you can get on Facebook or Twitter, then you could really get a sense of what's happening outside in the world, specifically in the exile community with all the celebrations in Little Havana. Nikki, Todd.
Thank you, Hatzel. Hatzel live in Havana, Cuba for us. We'll see you later today on Local 10 News.
And as Cuba is in its second of a 9-day mourning period, Cuban Americans in South Florida are on the second day of celebrating.
Since the news broke, many have been emotional, saying that this was a moment they had hoped for, and they hope that there's also change. That's what they're really hoping for. Well, joining us now to talk more about it, Dr. Andy Gomez. He is a political analyst and consultant, a retired senior fellow at the Cuban Studies of University of Miami.
Also joining us is Rafael Penalver, Cuban expert and the president of the San Carlos Institute. The institute works out of the historic landmark, which is considered an important place for Cuba's independence movement.
And Daniel Jimenez, he is the founder of Cuba One Foundation. The organization offers free trips to young Cuban Americans. Thank you, guys.
All right. Well, Andy, let's start with you because we feel like we're old friends now that we have sat through the marathon coverage that we had yesterday, and you joined us for that, and we thank you for that.
My pleasure.
Have you had time now to process the death of Fidel? And looking back at not only the way it unfolded, but the reaction both here in South Florida and now on the island and around the world. What are your thoughts?
Well, let me just say it's a pleasure to be with you again. It's a bittersweet moment, as I said all along. There's a moment of jubilation. We've been waiting, in my case, all of my life for that particular moment. But it's also, we need to recognize nothing has changed on the island. Fidel has been out of the picture since 2006. And as I stated yesterday, repression under Raul Castro has been worse than under Fidel. But for us Cuban Americans, I'm very proud of it. You know, I lost mom and dad, and I thought of them.
Yeah. A lot of personal stories really coming out of this.
And for them, that would have been a very special moment. You know, yeah. And unfortunately, they're not around.
Yeah. Rafael, you said that you felt that you were proud of the Cuban-American exile community and that there was one thing that it was consistent now.
I think that the whole expression, if you went down to 8th Street like I have been there for the past two nights, and I took my children to share this moment, and so many young people who are there saying, I am here not only for myself, but also representing my mother or my father or both, who died along the way.
It was multi-generational.
It was a multi-generational, both. That's the hope for Cuba, the young people here and the young people in Cuba. The fact that so many years have passed, and yet the ideals of the Cuban exile continue to be the same, the idea of Cuba's freedom, that they have not been lured by the material wealth and success and even the freedoms of this country, that we still have a commitment to that goal of our parents for a free and democratic Cuba. That's important. The Cuban exile community has shown that Fidel Castro is dead, but the Cuban exile community is very much alive.
Well, it's a good thing we got a young person here, huh?
You run a foundation that takes young people, Cuban Americans, to Cuba for the first time.
Yeah, we feel like it's very important for our generation to go through a process of reconciliation within the Cuban American community to reconcile across generations. We also feel like it's very important, it's our form of patriotism as young Cuban Americans to engage with the Cuban people, to go to Cuba, to meet peers, and to connect with them. And it's so important for us to hold on to our culture as Cuban Americans. we've been in this struggle for over 50 years. That's almost twice as old as I am, that we've, as Cuban Americans in exile, have been going through. For us to keep hold of our culture, to know what Cuba is, to meet our families that we've been separated from for 30 years is incredibly important.
Now, you're the social media savvy, group. Have you been communicating with anybody down there on social media since this happened, and what kind of information are you getting?
Yeah, I mean, as they were talking about with the Wi-Fi, you go out on the Maya Conner, everybody's on their smartphones, checking Facebook, posting pictures. It's been, I think, amazing over the past day how few people are out on the streets in Cuba. How few young people are out there, how few people are like posting pictures of empty streets all across Havana.
But do they see what's happening here?
And this is not a celebration. I mean, that's what we're very clear. We're not celebrating the death of anyone. No matter how evil a person is, you don't celebrate a person's death. This is a celebration that this sad chapter in Cuba's history is entering its final phase, and that we are now looking to the future. This is not an expression of hatred, it's an expression of hope.
While there was a lot of optimism, and it certainly was a celebration, as you called it, I felt it was tempered. I felt that the way it unfolded with Castro relinquishing power 10 years ago, at Raul putting himself firmly in place, that I felt like some people felt almost robbed of the moment that they were expecting.
Well, the celebration will come the day the Castros are out of power.
This is also process of the maturation of the Cuban-American community. If you go back 10 years, when it was announced that Fidel was sick or close to his death, you remember that the numbers were huge out on the streets. Most of the celebrations, as Rafael was mentioning, took places in people's home, because I talked to a number of my friends where parents, grandparents, their kids gather to relive Cuba's history and how we got here. There's an important point, again, that you mentioned. This is the beginning for many of us, now that Fidel's out of the picture, of beginning to see that there might be a little bit of a light at the end of the tunnel. Yep. But let us not forget what the Cuban people still live today. Part of the issue why we do not see people on the streets in the last 48 hours is because they have lived under this culture of fear that now they do not know how to act, whether to be out on the streets, and I dare to say the majority of the young Cubans your age have not supported this ideology for a long time. But at the same time, they are concerned, they are afraid of what the repercussions might be from the Cuban government. So it's a give and go.
Well, for example, Hatzla just mentioned, the ladies in white did not do their planned march.
That surprises me that they canceled it.
Saying, quote, out of respect. Now, is that out of respect? Is that genuine? Or is there some intimidation involved?
Look, the last time I was in Cuba for Pope Francis, a little bit more than a year ago, all the opposition leaders, or so-called identified opposition leaders, were put under house arrest, if we can call it that. Their Wi-Fi was blocked, their landlines were cut, and their cell phones were blocked. So it wouldn't surprise me that the ladies in white were intimidated and told the repercussions of you being on the streets, as you do every Sunday, would be jail.
But just think of what we're discussing here. We're talking about the Wi-Fi not functioning. Wi-Fi never functions in Cuba. Wi-Fi is a very edited Wi-Fi in a very few selected spots where tourists go. Right. The people of Cuba do not have access to Wi-Fi. The people of Cuba, when we talk about the ladies in white being allowed one march on Sundays on one street, if somebody tries to do it in the street over, they will be arrested and then harassed. So this is a total repressive regime that maintains its power purely by the repressive mechanism that unfortunately is being funded by foreigners going to invest there, foreigners that are doing business in Cuba, not with the Cuban people, but with the Cuban government. And that's what we really have to address.
Well, the single most important factor in the Arab Spring was apparently Twitter and social media,
right,
and the way that they were able to gather.
Yeah. Yeah.
Is there a possibility that they could see more social media and access to
it? I think it's important to remember that Cuba is much more than about than one person. Cuba is 11 million people on the island and 2 million people in exile around the world. This what has happened yesterday is an opportunity for a new day. It's an opportunity for reconciliation across generations, and it's an opportunity for the youth in Cuba and for Cuba as a whole to have a new future. I look forward to seeing what that is.
Okay. All right, thank you. It's a good place for us to take a break. Lots more to talk about as we continue our coverage of the death of Fidel Castro and what happens next. We'll be right back. Welcome back to this special edition of This Week in South Florida as we talk about Fidel Castro's death and the aftermath.
Dr. Andy Gomez, he's a political analyst and consultant. He's retired as senior fellow in Cuban studies at the University of Miami. Good to have you here.
That's
also,
right.
Also, Rafael Penalver, a Cuban expert and the president of the San Carlos Institute. The institute works out of the historic landmark, I think it's in Key West, correct?
Key West, right? Yeah.
And of course, we cannot forget.
Yes, sir. Daniel Jimenez, he is the founder of Cuba One Foundation, the organization that offers free trips to young people. And you say by young Cuban Americans going to Cuba and connecting with other young people, that's how you believe that, you know, there'll be more of a relationship and more of a dialogue.
Well, I think this changing of generations is something that's happening. It's happening when we see Fidel's death. It's happening with my grandfather dying last year and not being able to see yesterday. But it's only going to continue over time. As young people in Cuba are having an opportunity to chart their own course, to start their own small businesses as cuenta propistas, we're going to see more and more conversations happening. That I think about a participant we brought down in June, who is a skateboard photographer in LA, and he went down and skated with 20 or 30 Cuban skateboarders in June. Has since brought skateboards down to Cuba and is on regular contact with these guys on Instagram and is bringing two of them to an international skate competition in Tampa. That sort of engagement is empowering individuals. It's giving them an opportunity to get their word out and have a voice.
Over the last 36 hours, we've been immersed in this coverage, and I just have to wonder, are we, in a sense, a little bit in a bubble? You know, listening to NPR on the way home or tuning into the BBC.
Seeing what's coming out of France, seeing what's coming out of Spain.
Down the road, in the future, are we going to be on the right side of history, or is this going to be a skewed view?
We'll have to wait to a great
extent. Is that a loaded question?
No, we'll have to wait. But I think the next step, the ball now has shifted into Raul Castro's court, even though I think Fidel's influence in how Raul has been running the country for the last couple of years has been minimal to none.
Right.
The older generation of the Cuban population today on the island are Fidelistas. And for that reason, we're going to see, out of curiosity and out of love, respect, or whatever it might be, people out on the streets in La Plaza de la Revolución, or what I like to call it, La Plaza Cívica, mm-hmm. not La Revolución. Out on the street, paying, if we want to call it, respect to Fidel Castro's death. But at the same time, going back to your point, Daniel, what can Raul offer the Cuban people and Cuba's youth for them to see hope, no matter what we do, for them to see hope and and to keep them on that island? Because you got to think, and I know now, the majority of Cuba's youth has this contradiction of the ideology that they were brought up with, to realizing that they were misled, to an absence of an ideology. And they want to see change now. President Obama's speech in Havana a while ago created a great deal of hope, regardless whether you agree with his policies or not. But his speech in Havana created a great deal of hope, particularly for Cuba's youth. But it's not the president of the United States, going to your original question, Todd, or even us from Miami, that can create that avenue for them. We can support them. It is Raul Castro. What is Raul Castro going to be willing to change that they have not done for 57 years.
Yeah. Raul Castro took power 10 years ago, yeah. But a lot of people believe that Fidel still had a big impact. With Fidel gone, will we see, can the Castro regime as we've known it continue with just Raul?
Raul will do anything to survive. Just like Fidel, Fidel was not a communist. They have no ideology other than to hold on to power. They will adjust enough to enable them to survive in power by maintaining the repressive mechanism. Remember, in Cuba, public opinion doesn't count. The only thing that counts is guns and repression. So they will open up enough to allow a few selected foreigners to go through what I call the funnel. The funnel enables you to go in and to become a partner of the regime, a partner of one of the Castros or one of the generals. They will then give you a very lucrative business opportunity, and you in return will do whatever you can to make sure that there are no changes in Cuba that will threaten your privileged position. They will adjust so that the world thinks that they are going to be making changes, and by time, that's not real change. The real change has to come when we deal directly and give opportunities directly to the Cuban people, and that they will not do, because they know the moment the Cuban people are empowered, they will lose power.
But by letting in all these foreners, letting in all these people with money, and seeing some opportunities.
They are not allowing
the cruise ships, visitors. That's
Nikki. It's just a very few. They will not allow. If I would be the first one supporting a total opening, that you didn't have to go through the funnel. That any foreigner could go and deal directly with a Cuban down the street and make him your partner and open a business with them. Castro will never allow that. The moment they allow that, that will be the end of the regime. They will make artificial cosmetic changes to think that the world thinks that they're making progress, but there will not be a free Cuba until the Castros are gone.
Well, foreign investment has been in Cuba before we established diplomatic relations with Cuba 2 years ago. Money has been coming in. How can the Cuban government then, using their figures, come out and say that by the end of next month, their economy will have grown less than 1% in 2016? Where's the money going? That's what Rafael was saying. Even Raul Castro, in one of his recent speeches to the National Assembly in Cuba, admitted that the corruption within the system must be corrected if the system is going to survive. This is the leader of a country admitting that the corruption. So, you know, this is not, where's the money going? It's not going to the Cuban people.
Daniel, quickly, is there a way they can widen the funnel?
I think the more people that go to Cuba and have real conversations with real Cuban people, the better off we're all going to be. I just want to say about this situation we're in right now, the conversation I had with my father yesterday was transformative and changing. Please, everyone, talk with your kids about what it means to be Cuban American, what the experience that you went through when you were going into exile. That's an incredibly important moment.
Yeah, so that's a conversation I'm sure many people are having as we speak. Daniel, thank you so much for joining us. Andy, Rafael.
Thank you so much.
Good to see you.
Yeah. Really good to see you.
Yes. Good to
Let's hope it's a while before
you.
We see you.
This is a conversation we'll be having, I'm sure.
And freedom is always in the right side of history.
Absolutely.
So that's why I always feel in the end, truth and freedom will prevail.
Gentlemen, an enlightening conversation. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
We'll be right back.
Welcome back to this special edition of This Week in South Florida as we cover the death of Fidel Castro.
Let's introduce you to today's roundtable guest. We start off with Joe Cardona. He is a documentary filmmaker in Miami. He also writes an occasional op-ed column for the Miami Herald. And we're glad to welcome you here for the first time, Joe. Thanks for being here.
We also have Raul Moas, who is the executive director of Roots of Hope, an organization that works with young people in Cuba.
And Rafael Yanis, a political analyst, a UM and UF alum, and a young Cuban American with plenty of opinions. We're going to start off, gentlemen, with the looming possibility of change in Cuba. And we don't know what direction that's going to take. But President Obama and his executive orders that have been in place, and now President-elect Trump vowing to undo those orders. This uncertainty, how much angst does that cause on the island, and how much angst does it cause in the Cuban-American community?
I think certainly we're going to see change, the tone even in the messages, right? The condolences from the White House, from President Obama, and then the statements from the Trump.
What a dichotomy.
Completely different. So every indication seems to be that that incoming president will do away with some of those executive orders. Now, what effect that has on relations with Cuba, on the Cuban people, you know, remains to be seen.
What effect it has on the business interests in the United States as well. You know, people and a lot of South Florida businessmen and women have injected a lot of money.
Well, here's the thing, though. When you hitch your wagon to a government like Cuba's government, which is an unstable dictatorship, and let's call it for what it is, it's a dictatorship. That's a very tricky, you know, proposition. So I think a lot of people are now finding themselves in that very difficult position of, well, now with the transition to a new administration, what does it mean to my business interests? How secure are my investments in Cuba? I think anybody that knows a little bit about finance would tell somebody it's not the most secure investment in the world.
To your original question about does it cause angst in Cuba, I do think that amongst kind of the small business owning class that has started to grow slowly but steadily over the last few years, it does cause some anxiety, right? And I think we need to think about their business interests and what their businesses mean to them. They're looking for a more dignified way to provide a better life for their families. They've chosen to stay in Cuba, plant a stake. A lot of the work we do is in support of those small businesses because we think that economic empowerment is good for them. And I'll share that from the folks that have gone through our programs or just general folks that we're in touch with. There is some anxiety as to whether they, as small business owners, will be limited if some of these restrictions or some of these changes that happened recently will be rolled back.
It's important to remember, though, that the business interests in Cuba, the very limited business, which were mentioned in the last panel, the cuentas propistas, small business owners, they're under the rule of a tyrant, Raul Castro. And Ileana, Mario, Carlos, Marco, President Trump, everybody, President-elect Trump, everybody has hit the nail on the head that Raul Castro is still in power. And the game hasn't changed. Now, a tyrant in Fidel Castro, the chief villain in the Cuban story for the last 60 plus years, is dead. That's an important step forward. That's the next step. And one of the past panelists also mentioned that it's the light at the end of the tunnel. We're looking forward to the future. And that's why I'm personally hopeful that all the changes that have happened in the last 2 years, which were made under a very poorly negotiated and executed deal by President Obama's team, are going to face opposition in President Trump's administration. We're going to see true business leaders negotiating a very complicated and sensitive deal, and that's going to ultimately benefit the Cuban people.
I would only push back a little bit there in saying that all of the business interests that Cuenta Propista, that small business owners in Cuba have, independent business owners have, are controlled by a tyrant. I think it's a monolithic and somewhat simplistic argument to think
of
Cuba.
I would disagree. The Cuban government owns all the means of production, and they own Alamport. The Cuenta Propistas are normally, you know, small paladares and small restaurants. And, you know, your organization tells people, go eat at those small restaurants. Well, where do they buy their food? They're buying their food from Alamport. Who does Alamport buy their food from? It's the government. It's owned by the military.
So I think this is
so
where
you can't
we
call
fall.
It a monolithic. You can't call it a monolithic or...
If you let me get a thought
well,
here.
But you can't call it a monolithic opinion when it's reality, Raul.
I think it is a monolithic opinion.
Yeah. A moment to respond.
Sure. It is a monolithic opinion because of the following. I think that when we think of Cuba, it's very easy and somewhat self-soothing for our community to say that everything that happens there goes through the government, and sometimes we remove ourselves from the real life, from the reality of the everyday Cuban. It is incredibly empowering for Cubans of everyday Cubans of ordinary walks of life to have a small business. You're completely right. Yeah, the source of wholesale items in Cuba comes from government-controlled industries, but the empowerment that happens at the individual owner's level, at the individual Cuban's level, from the small business is transformative and meaningful, and I would venture to say takes away power from the Cuban state little by little and gives it to the everyday Cuban. And if we're thinking about a totalitarian state, if you can take power from the state and give it back to the people, I think that's good.
Well, the best way to do that would be to support policies here in the United States and the U.S. Congress, which I support, which would limit the means of the Cuban government to repress the people that it's supposedly governing. You know, these people are living under fear and repression that at any moment, Raul and his economic apparatchiks can take away the limited economic openings they've given them. Yes, there have been limited economic openings, but not the right style of openings. You know, Rafael Peñavera, Andy Gomez, they were hitting the nail on the head. They want to do business with individual Cubans who can then have their rights respected.
Right, but to throw the baby out with the bathwater and to say, let's completely disengage from Cuba,
I'm not arguing that. I'm not arguing that we
need to completely disengage. So what I'm saying is, let's modify, perhaps, the Obama approach and say, we can get more in this deal, right? But what we shouldn't be doing, in my opinion, is completely pulling back and disengaging with the Cuban people. Yeah. I think the steps that we've taken forward are positive.
Okay, if President-elect Trump, he's in our area, not too far from our area. Say he say he was taking a look at this, because the death of Fidel Castro obviously makes this more urgent on his agenda.
It could be a game changer.
A very interesting time. What would you like to see done?
Look, in my opinion, it's partisan politics, right? I mean, the statements coming in and about from different political figures. I mean, Trump's statement, how much does Trump really know about Cuba? You know, it's been reported that he wanted to do business in Cuba before. Now he's taken a 360 turn. So, you know, what his administration is, this guy, I don't know, he hasn't assigned a Secretary of State yet. So I don't even know that that's all set in place. What the future of relations with Cuba hold, we don't know. What I would urge is to not throw out the baby with the bathwater. There were some important measures taken under the Obama administration, and I was the first critic. I was the guy to say and write, listen, not enough is being exacted and demanded from the Cuban government. However, don't disengage with the Cuban people.
Well, Cuba is not on President-elect Trump's agenda for the first 100 days in office, but that begs the question. Now, with the death of Fidel, is this an opportunity for President-elect Trump to show, is it a power play? Is it an opportunity for him to show that he's a powerful leader with minimal risk?
Well, President-elect Trump is best known for the art of the deal. He's a businessman, and whether you love him or hate him, he is a businessman who's focused on cutting deals. And we look at this current administration has cut terrible deals around the world for us. You know, the Iran nuclear deal, Cuba, this is all interrelated. You have to consider the geopolitical consequences now of how we move with Cuba, Venezuela, Iran, because the Cuban regime has been propping up the Venezuelan regime. And the Venezuelan regime has been the access point for Hezbollah fighters, and this has all been documented by various NGOs and foreign governments.
So does he move up the Cuban agenda?
I think it's all interrelated. If he doesn't list in the first 100 days that Cuba's on that bullet-pointed list that you're referring to, it's still in the background. And the National Security Director, you know, the National Security Advisor, they're going to have to work together with our intelligence agencies
on how they're
going to work with Cuba.
Whoever those are, because we don't know who they are yet. And to your point, and Raul, I want you to jump in on it, the opportunity, right? If Trump is anything, it's an opportunist. So is he going to jump on it as an opportunity to now, as you said, have a low-risk intervention, you know, what is it going to be?
Okay, Raul, I'm going to ask you to hold that thought because this is a very interesting conversation. We're going to get back to it when our roundtable continues when we come right back.
Welcome back to This Week in South Florida, as Michael Putney would say, a very spirited roundtable. Joe Cardona is a documentary filmmaker in Miami, also writes an occasional op-ed column for the Miami Herald. Glad to have you here, Joe.
That's right. We're also joined by Raul Moas, who is the executive director of Roots of Hope, an organization that works with young people in Cuba, and Rafael Yanis, a political analyst, UM and UF alum, and a young Cuban American.
Before we went to break, Nikki said, Raul, hold your thought. You said you're going to pivot on that, so you're going to put that thought in your pocket. We're going to move on, all right?
Yeah, sounds good.
We want to talk about a little bit about the personal stories. Our previous guests talking about their personal stories about being Cuban Americans, and one of our guests got emotional.
Right?
Yes. It was clear to see.
Yes.
What's your story?
Well, my parents left Cuba very early, at 15 and 6 years old, and you know, I can't begin to fathom the pain that my grandparents felt on my dad's side. He left on a company with Pedro Pan through the Catholic Charities and the U.S. government. My mother left with her parents in the first boat lift out after the Cuban Missile Crisis. So she had the benefit of leaving with her parents. My father had no benefit other than the Cuban the Catholic Charities and the American government were welcoming him. And to hear the stories of struggle, you know, going from a life that you know, a language, family, friends, your neighborhood, to go to a country where you don't know anyone except for other Cubans who've left with you, that you have no idea of how long you're going to be here. And that's something that my parents and my grandparents always reminded me, that when they first came, it wasn't an overnight switch. They didn't think that, okay, we're here and we're staying. They were always looking at, when can I go back? And that's where I think the raw emotion comes into our generation, that our grandparents, many of whom died hoping one day to go back to Cuba that wasn't under repression. You know, my parents have given me so many gifts and so many privileges that I'm so grateful for, that this country allowed them to succeed where they would have had those opportunities in Cuba.
Raul just cast in his chips that I want to talk.
No, so I think that it's when you go to either La Carreta or Versailles, you see a lot of young people. And when you go on social media, be it Twitter, Facebook, or Instagram, you're seeing a lot of young people say two things, same sentiment. One is either, I'm so happy that I was able to share this moment with my grandfather or grandmother, or I so badly wish that my grandparents were still around to share this. And I think our generation has inherited the pseudo-nostalgia. We empathize deeply with the sacrifice and the pain that our grandparents and our parents lived, and we feel that it's immensely ours. We're both fully American and have an American worldview, and we're also fully Cuban and appreciate and want the best for the Cuban people. And so one of the things that Daniel Jimenez was mentioning earlier, and Roots of Hope has been active in for years, is helping young people visit Cuba in a socially conscious way. Reconnecting with family, reconnecting with your heritage. And so I urge folks, as Daniel said earlier, to sit down with your parents, sit down with your grandparents, talk about it. And if it's right for you, if it's right for your family, think about visiting Cuba today. I think that's the biggest game changer. When you visit Cuba, everything you've heard is validated and disproven at the same time. Wholly a paradox, but it's an eye-opening experience.
But a lot of grandparents say they don't want you to go back.
You're completely right. My maternal grandmother was very much at peace when I went back for the first time. She was happy and encouraged it. So my paternal grandmother and my grandfather understood it was something I had to do for myself. But it kind of brought back to the surface a lot of pain and a lot of hurt. And so it's a deeply personal decision, and you have to talk about it with your family and see when and how is the right way for it.
Joe, I see you want to jump in.
Well, I respect all positions, meaning if you feel that going back is important, and you know, I support that, and I respect people who do not go back. One quick anecdote on the personal side. Both of my parents are passed, but my 9-year-old called me yesterday and said, "Papi, the bad man is gone."
Wow.
And so it tells you how deep it runs in our families. Yeah. So,
as evidence of the multi-generational gathering that we've seen over the past 36 hours, really something amazing. Let's talk a little bit more about Raul Castro. That guy. Yeah.
He has been preparing for this day for a very long time. A lot of people felt, and we had heard rumors that Fidel had been dead so many times.
Well, what about the military maneuvers, you know, in light of Trump's election? I think that had a lot more to do with Fidel's death, and I think he's been sitting in a pickle jar for maybe 3 or 4 days.
We've heard those too.
Or his health was deteriorating,
failing.
And they knew it was going
to
fail soon.
And suddenly Raul comes on national TV and gives this very opaque kind of announcement that his brother's
passed. Think this was timed?
I think it was timed, yeah. I mean, maybe not his death. I don't think they pulled the plug on him.
No, I don't mean that.
But I think they prepared
the announcement
for it. I think they prepared for it. And now we have 9 days of mourning.
Right.
Now think of the ramifications on South Florida. For example, exchange of musicians. There are a lot of musicians that go back and forth, and I'm very familiar with the music industry, back and forth from Cuba. Now what does a musician that has ties to the island do in these next 9 days? Do you go ahead and play a scheduled concert in Miami and then have to return to Cuba and meet with, you know, people within the Ministry of the Arts, and how do you explain that one? I mean, this is a 9-day period of mourning. This is as if, you know,
a pope had died.
Well, that's the same mourning period as a pope. Some experts say that Raul is expected to tighten his grip, at least in the short term, in the coming days. Agree?
Well, he wants to prove that he's still in command. Right. He needs to show the Cuban people he's still in command. That's why reports from Hatzel Vela and soon, I guess, Glenna and Calvin are going down, that it's going to show that they are intimidating people quiet. It's the soft intimidation versus the hard intimidation. And right now, they can't afford, with all the international press in Cuba, to show the hard intimidation. Who knows what they told Berta Soler and the ladies in white, that you shouldn't go out. Maybe this Sunday is not a good Sunday for you to go out.
I think that's incredible speculation on our part here. Yeah. Berta Soler is capable and has the ability to make her own conclusions and decisions. And I do think that for a lot of people in Cuba, this is actually a traumatic experience. There is pain and hurt. And I actually think that when you're an opposition leader and you're fighting for the hearts and minds of the Cuban people, it is perhaps wise to honor the fact that for many people that you're trying to dialogue with and convince to see your viewpoint, to honor their pain. And so I think it's, again, we're falling into the trap of Miami politics and casting our view and speculation.
And it's also politically
happening.
Wise not to go out and
It is politically 100%. Wise on their part to respect the government's 9 days of mourning. But what's important to look at is, what are the influences behind that decision? The calculation of wanting to win the hearts and minds is very valid and probably a key part of her decision.
But they've certainly been beaten.
But they
dragged.
Have been beaten so many times that who knows.
It's not wild speculation.
Correct.
Right. It certainly is a conversation we'll continue to have throughout the week. Glenna and Hatzel and Calvin are there. They can bring us reports. Thank you so much.
Thank
I'm sure
you.
We'll
Thank
call
you
on you again us. As this conversation continues.
Thank you.
Well, when the news broke, the celebrations certainly began out on the streets.
At the center was the iconic Café Versailles. We'll have a live report ahead after the break. Café Versailles is an iconic restaurant for Cubans in Miami. And of course, when the news broke out about Fidel Castro's death, it became the site of celebrations. Those celebrations went well into the night.
Laren Livingston is live in front of the restaurant in Little Havana and has been for the last two mornings. Good morning, Laren.
Good morning, Todd. Good morning, Nikki. We've been here since early this morning, and I'll tell you, this sidewalk did not look like this just a few hours ago. But as you can see, people have started to fill this sidewalk once again. Not the streets, per se, like they were a couple of nights ago, but you can hear also as the cars drive by. They're holding their flags. Somebody came by with a cowbell not too long ago, and they're driving by. They're blowing those horns. Of course, the celebration here in Little Havana on Calle Ocho continues. I want you to go out to the street there. Miami police tell us that they don't plan on shutting down the street right now, but they have been here all morning long. They have been working the traffic right now ever since it picked up and these cars started coming through here this morning. And they said if they have to do so, they will definitely shut the street down if necessary. And of course, you were talking about those very personal stories this morning. We've been speaking to a lot of people. You hear this gentleman behind me getting his story out, or at least trying to do so. And we've been talking to people all morning who have been more than willing to share their personal stories. I spoke with one woman who says she left Cuba in the 60s as a five-year-old with her family, and she says she's never been able to go back to her homeland, and now she's hopeful that with Castro's death that she'll be able to do so. Here's what she had to say this morning.
I don't know where I live and where my mother was born with her brother and a farm that I don't know, and it hurts so much.
I can't die today. I can't die, you understand? I can't die today because the bad man is gone. I'm happy today.
And back live here, you see these young girls right here with their Cuban dresses, their Cuban shirts, their flags, and their signs. And of course, more and more people continue to show up here outside of Cafe Versailles. This has been the de facto demonstration point. People not necessarily excited about Castro's death, but again, celebrating the hope that they have that Cuba that they knew, that their parents knew, that their grandparents knew, may be a different Cuba in the future with the passing of Fidel Castro. Nikki, talk.
All right, Laren, thank you very much.
Well, the weekend weather has certainly been holding up as we round out the holiday weekend.
A live look outside of our Hollywood Beach camera. Jennifer Correa, our weather authority, has an update right around the corner. A live look now from our Miami Tower cam. Here is Weather Authority meteorologist Jennifer Correa with your Sunday forecast.
Good afternoon, South Florida. Temperatures warming up to the upper 70s already, but it hasn't been a quick warm up. We did start off slightly cooler this morning because of northerly wind and due to the fact that a weak cold front has been passing through. Showers that have been offshore this morning finally dissipating. They did hit the coastline, especially for Miami-Dade. We did get some rain out there. Now high pressure will be the influence of our weather as we head into the rest of today and for the start of the new week. By the way, dry air also filtering in. This is allowing for those showers to dissipate, but we could still have some lingering clouds on the tail end of that dissipating cold front over the Keys this afternoon. By tomorrow, breezy conditions in the morning, showers along the breeze. Then for Tuesday, mild and partly sunny, and we're going to really warm things up as we head into the start of December out ahead of that next cold front that's coming in from the west. How warm will it get? Well, by Thursday into the mid 80s, which is pretty significant for this time of year.
All right. Thank you, Jennifer. Well, what do you think?
I think it went well.
I think so, too. But what do you think? I mean, not you. We invite you, the public, the viewers, to weigh in on any topic you'd like. Email, Facebook, Twitter. We read all of them at any of these addresses. We're very easy to find.
And on behalf of Michael Putney and Glenna Milberg, we thank you for tuning in to This Week in South Florida. In the words of our colleagues, stay informed, get involved. They will both be back here in these seats next week. I'm sure they are looking forward to seeing you here.
Have a great Sunday.
Bye-bye.